Now, I did have a long series of questions ready to ask Pat, but he surprised me by saying that he'd had a dream about a space spinner last night, so I thought we'd maybe get into that to start with.
Yeah, I mean, it's not something I normally think about, but last night I had this really vivid dream, and tell me it's fairly obvious what it means, but the space spinner was flying through the air, and sort of blazing with light, and it was razor sharp, and it proceeded to slice through the heads of lots of people. And
any politicians or?
Well, that's the frustrating thing. I don't know who it was decapitating, but it was decapitating loads of people. And in my dream, and when I woke up, I was thinking, wow, there's a bloody good story in this. So I shall never look at the space spinner in quite the same way again.
Perfectly normal. I can't see any problems with that dream at all, Pat. No, none of it at all.
Yeah. So it gives a sign of the way 2000 AD was going to go, really, doesn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, maybe that was subconsciously what you wanted to do, yeah. When you shot Maggie on the steps there, you thought, you know...
That's right.
Yeah, maybe.
Okay. I should have, yeah. She could have been decapitated by the Frisbee, yeah.
So going back to before 2000 AD, what was it that made you think... Now, I mean, writing isn't the most normal of jobs. You're making up stories for a living. It's not something everyone aspires to. What drove you to write and keep writing now? What was it that drives you on now?
Well, I suppose back then, I think it's one of those working class things that you think, how can I get the hell out of this particular situation? You know, some people go on and become footballers or something right. like that, and you think, how can I make some money? How can I get out of, ending up in a factory or whatever it is?
Okay.
So that was very much a feeling quite early on. I submitted my first story to the BBC when I was about 9.
Can you remember what it was? Was it?
It was fantasy. It was sort of fairy tale kind of thing. And I remember thinking, oh, somebody got published when they were 10, and thinking, God, I'm running out of time.
Thank God there was no Twitter. You were doing too much pressure.
Yeah. And I suppose, like any job, once you start doing it, it's, what else can you do? Do you know what I mean? I think I'd be pretty unemployable in any other
So, I mean, what drives you now to think of stories? Because you have to keep coming up with new stories and new stories. Is there anything that sort of, you think, oh, there's competition out there, or there's something that comes to me as a subject on television or a subject I'm reading about? Is it something that pushes you on to create, or is it...
Yeah, I haven't really been able to identify it in any, objective way.
Okay.
As everyone here will know, familiar with my stuff, is it's all got to have that subversive subtext.
Yeah.
And on rare occasions when I've moved away from that to, what should we say, more middle-of-the-road writing, it hasn't really worked. And I don't think it's really a lack of ability on my part. It's just not meant to be. In other words... without getting too esoteric, I mean, it's what I'm meant to do. And if I don't do it, it's like an itch I've got to scratch. Yeah, I have to do this. And so, for example, there was an era in 2000 AD where, not now really, but in the past, where they were really trying to steer it away from its, its subversive and cynical roots and make it something else. And I felt very threatened by that, not so much from an economic point of view, but it's like, where does this leave me? I can't write middle-of-the-road stuff. I can't, it has to have that edge. And if it hasn't got that edge, I would be very bored. So, for example, in this novel that I wrote with Kevin O'Neill, we cover... in a fictional way, the whole era of Whizzer and Chips and Shiver and Shake and Core, all of which I wrote for, and I'm sorry if any of you guys are avid, but if you read this, I think it's one area where Kevin and I were actually really quite passionate, and I like to think we were funny in it, but there's a very strong edge of bitterness because it's so formulaic and so very different, for example, to D.C. Thompson's, who had this wonderful Leo Baxendale material and so on, which, of course, also came over to IPC. But it's that lack of soul. And I actually describe that in the book. It's an era where I was writing with John Wagner, and we were writing in a garden shed. And I was so effing bored by writing this stuff because it's all down to a formula. I mean, it's funny out of a can. And I mean, it's really hard to describe, but how I tried to solve the problem was I wrote it on a continuous roll of wallpaper so that I never had to take the paper out of the typewriter so I could keep going.
Wow, okay.
Otherwise, I would be so bloody bored. And you'll see there's a bit in there, and I think it's probably the most passionate part of the... You know, that most of the novel is fiction, but that bit, where John and I were writing in a garden shed, I mean, I was surprised by how much, I don't know, anger's the wrong word, how much
passion,
emotion.
Passion, maybe, yeah.
Yeah, how much passion. You think, God, after over 40 years, you know, what does it matter?
Yeah.
But yeah, I still want those missing, I think I wrote for Core and so on for, I don't know, 2 or 3 years. And I still want those bloody years back.
Right. Now, we will get on to Read 'Em and Weep in a bit. We will talk to that in the second half of the interview. But I wanted to go back to the what it was like in the 70s to create a comic for you, because it was a time of social unrest and people were unhappy and many people were quite poor. Do you think that that was something that spurred on a lot of, because there's a lot of great characters, a lot of great situations that come from that time. Do you think that spurred you on?
Yeah. I mean... My take on it at the time was that music and film and books were all changing after the 60s. And, you know, you had German heroes with Sven Hassel.
Yeah.
You had G.F. Newman's stories about police corruption. Whereas up till then it had been Dixon and Doc Green. And so there was change everywhere. Except in one area, in comics.
Okay.
And comics were stuck in the past, but the IPC comics, which I was connected with, were stuck in a bad way. Now, I still carry a small torch for DC Thompson's, where I got my training, because they had stories that were really stuck in the past.
Right.
But they were so well done.
Right.
And I'm probably the only one who ever likes, well, certainly the story I'm about to tell you. It was my favorite story. It was in Hotspur. Now, you can see who the hell is going to read this? Obviously, only someone like me. It's a story about a guy who's got a Suffolk Punch horse called Big Brutus. That's the title of the story. And he goes from village to village with this Suffolk Punch horse, shifting things around and getting into little adventures. And I thought this was fascinating. But who the hell else is? It's like, for God's sake, you know. But I kind of admire their obscure style, you know. But who the hell is going to buy that? I mean, it's not even afternoon TV viewing, is it?
It's
sort of not even It Shouldn't Happen to a Vet. And they had loads of these stories. I think the reason I liked them was because they were so well written, whereas the majority, I mean, not everyone will agree with this, but the majority of stories in IPC were not well written. They weren't well crafted, and there was no love behind them. So one of the major writers of his day, first thing he said to me was, I think I mentioned in the book, he said, I make more money than the British Prime Minister.
Yeah.
And he said, how many stories can you write in a day? And I went, one in every 2 or 3 days. I can do 3 in a day.
It's like it's a competition.
Yeah, it was all about speed. Right. It's just wretched, wretched.
Right.
Yeah.
So do you think we're returning to that period? Do you think we're returning now to a period of creativity where things are, unrest is beginning again, isn't it? You've got the likes of the political climate. Do you think it's going to become that spawning ground for great stories again?
Well, it's got to happen, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Because there's so much economic deprivation. So the kind of circumstances that created 2000 AD's crisis, I think we're back there again, only worse. And so from 2000 AD's point of view, I think the challenge we all have is we've caught up with the future, because that's the whole thing. When the comic started, the publisher, it was very much the publisher's dream. He said, the way to present it to the readers is, this is a future you're going to be living in. And we are now living in it. And it's and you look at robots and things, and they're exactly like Robusters.
Yeah.
And then you look at Trump and you think, God, you know, how is John Wagner going to, you know, how can you make someone, you know, Judge Cal looks, you know, fairly small beer by comparison. And it's, what do you do? I mean, it is a challenge when, you know, you can go on YouTube and if you're cynical enough, you know, laugh yourself silly watching some ridiculous pronouncement of his.
I mean, back in the day, we thought Reagan was a gift, didn't we? But
yeah, actually, now Reagan seems okay now. I mean, we were taking the piss out of Carter in The Cursed Earth, but of course now he seems like a total Democrat and so on. So I don't know where that leaves us. It is a disturbing thing, and the fact that there was always that feeling with science fiction, it was kind of comforting because you could always talk about a possible dystopia and a possible Armageddon that was round the corner, but it's a bit bloody, it's no longer round the corner. So I'm not sure. I mean, bear in mind, I mean, you know, everybody was growing up in the Cold War, and I mean, in a way it's remarkable when you think of a story like Invasion, where we're actually saying the Russians are here.
They are, they're in our computers now, you know, aren't they, essentially, you know.
I mean, I suppose in a way that must have meant those early stories were very daring.
Yeah.
The fact that we could actually talk about a Russian invasion. And that was actually the publisher's idea, that story. He said, have there a Russian invasion of Britain? And I said to him, but John, why would the Russians want to invade us? And he said, they're after our oil. And I said, well, I can't work up any, you know, real enthusiasm for portraying them as Nazis or anything. You know, obviously being a bit of a lefty. And so he said, read the Gulag Archipelago. That will change your mind. So I waded through the Gulag Archipelago and the Solzhenitsyn thing. And I still wasn't convinced. And he said, you know, you can have Maggie Thatcher shot on the steps of St. Paul's Cathedral. And I said, okay, John, I'm there.
I mean, you've always had very common man heroes from Charlie through all the way. I mean, even martial law can be seen as a sort of common man. Do you think comics should and are and maybe will be again a class war?
I think they should be.
Right.
And I have really ferocious views on this, which are probably not for public consumption. No, I'm really rabid on the subject. I think, it's going to sound like I'm a bit David Icke on this, but the majority of popular culture heroes are middle class or upper class. And that's fair enough. They're often written by authors who are middle class or upper class.
Yeah.
But it personally, I think it is good luck to them, except for the fact that we do not have enough working class heroes. And the reality that we all know is that in the field, it's invariably working class guys who will be leading in situations of danger and stress and so on. I mean, certainly I know from talking to friends in the army, you know, I'm grossly simplifying here, but often it isn't the officer, it's the sergeant or it's the ordinary guy. And that, so if you have ordinary kids, working class kids, whatever, I mean, the phrases are so awful now because they're so dated, but, you know, you want to read about heroes you can identify and you can say, I could be that guy. Yeah. So that's why Charlie's War is popular, because it's an ordinary kid.
Popular, you know.
Yeah. And there are far too many elite heroes. You think of all the classic ones. Sherlock Holmes, Ian Fleming's James Bond. The one that I can get really in a froth over, which I won't, is John Buchan, because he was the spin doctor of World War One. He was the Alistair Campbell of his day. Yeah. So those books, those Hanny books, had an agenda. And the more you look at that, the darker and nastier it is. And he was rewarded with the Governor Generalship of Canada. So all the kind of classics you think of, for the most part, are middle or upper class heroes. So, I mean, it's taken me a few years to be this articulate about it. But right, back in the 70s, I just got in a froth about it.
You know? Just shout at people. Yeah.
That's it.
Well, I wanted to move on to that about your inspirations for some of your characters. I mean, you and I chat about a couple of them quite a lot, but should we just run through a few of them? Let's run through a few. So, Nemesis and Torquemada.
Okay, well, that one's relatively simple because I'm on record with this. The monks at the school I went to, De La Salle monks, and they were pretty weird, and they were fanatical. So they were a major inspiration, not just for Torquemada, but for my particular interpretation of Judge Dredd.
Right, okay, interesting, yeah. And that was taken to another level when you joined with Kevin, I take it?
Well, you see, Kevin, coming from an Irish Catholic background like myself, well, I mean, it's like... so he, if you like, poured in all his... darkness, if you like, because I mean, you know, these people were pretty unwholesome individuals.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
And you've only got to look at the newspaper headlines. You know, you type in De La Salle monks or something, you're just as likely to find some awful account. So
yeah, definitely. Yeah. Sláine. Now, Sláine's has endured constantly and has been recreated. One of my favourites. Where did that come from? Where did that start with you?
Well, I think it started in a, if you like, in an absence way, because coming from an Irish background, I knew all the Irish heroes. I knew Michael Collins. My middle name is Eamon, after Eamon de Valera. Okay. And, you know, I knew all about Wolf Tone and so on. And I didn't know about these Celtic characters, these mythological characters like Cú Chulainn and Finn and so forth. And so when I started to research doing a barbarian story, because I felt it was time that 2000 AD had one,
yeah,
I suddenly discovered that I felt really cheated. I thought, why didn't I know about the warp spasm? You know, this is like, you know, I mean, I'd have loved to have known about that as a kid. So if you like, I was sort of fulfilling that gap, because these are great characters. And the other obsession I have is that we minimize our North European heritage, the sense of mythology, that we live in a magical part of the planet as well. Invariably, it's always Roman, Greek, Egyptian, and so on. And in the case of the Roman-Greek thing, that is very much the establishment. They minimize, again, I don't want to get too David Icke on this, but they minimize our natural heritage. So I'm currently doing a story about the mythology of Britain in Sláine, the Britannia Chronicles, where there's a King Brutus who is... from Troy. So you've got London as New Troy. Now, why aren't there popular, I don't know, children's books on this subject? They're missing. Now, there's a reason for that. It's like, no, we're not going to do this. We're going to go on about Jason and the Argonauts and all this kind of stuff. But we have the equivalent in our country. We have Stonehenge and all these other things. So that was very much a drive for me, that it had to have that rainy, wet, cold, grey, northern mythology. And a way, and then of course the other thing, that Nordic myths and legends are very structured. You know, you read some of the Viking sagas and so on. But Celtic myths, whether they're British, i.e. Welsh, or Scottish, or Irish, they're slightly weird. There's that weird, you know... that weird Celtic nature
and that appeals to you. That's
obviously, yeah. Well, I mean, you know, any of us have got, we've probably all got connections in there one way or another. Yeah. And it's part of our cultural heritage, but it's kind of minimized in place of what you might call a more Anglo-Saxon ordered. So, you know, you read something like Beowulf, it's, It's structured. You read Kukulcan and you think, what's this all about? This guy's on acid or something. Yeah. You know, it's just crazy.
So how much, for example, for Sláine, how much would you time would you spend researching it before you actually put pen to paper?
I spent a hell of a lot of time, just trying to absorb the character and his world. And I think what I was always looking for was that black comedy that dates back to our ancestors. So the phrase, for example, kiss my axe, actually comes from one of these old Celtic sagas.
Really? Okay.
And you think, wow, that's a natural for 2000 AD. And so I would mine these sagas, trying to capture that, it doesn't have to be necessarily Irish. I'll say Irish, but it could just as easily be Scottish or Welsh. That way of putting things, and my Irish relatives, that's on the West Coast, they still have that way of speaking. Like one of them was talking about someone who left the small town, and they said, it would have been better for her if she'd stayed beyond. And that's a wonderful way of putting things. And unfortunately, because I have this Anglo-Irish background, I can't quite, it doesn't come naturally to me, so I have to kind of sample it, either by talking to my relatives or from looking at the original sagas. But I'm fascinated by them, and anyone who's not familiar with it should check out The Toyne adaptation by Thomas Kinsella, which is wonderful. And he includes, what happened was the Christian monks, they clean them up. So I was looking for the foulest version, which Thomas Kinsella's is pretty foul.
You surprised me.
Yeah, and it says in there, the monk says, some things in here I believe to be true, some I believe to be lies, some I believe to be devilish fantasies, and some are for the enjoyment of idiots. And I thought, that's me. Yeah.
We'll get on to Marvel Comics in a minute, it's fine, yeah. Interesting. Okay, so I think this might be opening a can of worms, but what was the inspiration for martial law?
Well, yeah, that's self-evident, isn't it? Because, yeah, I mean, I have written a few superhero stories, but yeah, my heart's not really in it. Primarily, what was saying earlier about middle-class heroes, the majority of American superheroes are establishment figures. They're lawyers, they're newspaper reporters, photographers, whatever. They're middle-class figures. So martial law is deliberately, originally he was unemployed, now he's a hospital orderly, not a nurse, but an orderly, you know, he just wheels stuff around. And it is to show that you don't have to come from these rather more privileged backgrounds to be a hero. On the contrary. So, it's the same motivation as Charlie's War.
Okay. Do you think we need martial law back now? Do you think?
Well, Well, I thought when DC Comics took up the rights that were, you know, they were letting the fox in with the chickens, but I think they've outsmarted us, because they recently did give Kevin and I the go-ahead to do a new martial law story, and it got to, I mean, they actually approached us with this particular suggestion. This isn't Kevin and I trying
This was some time ago, was it? A couple of years ago?
God, maybe? I mean, this is the thing with DC, they take forever. So about 3 years ago, they said, would you like to do this particular crossover? And we are thinking, I'll tell you in a moment, are you serious? They said, yeah. And you said, you do know what martial law is about and everything. No, that's fine. Yeah, go for it. And so we did a preliminary synopsis, which I think was a little guarded. In other words, that there'll be a little conflict between martial law and this other gentleman and so on. But eventually, no, they got to the final stage and we thought, God, have we actually managed...
Being serious here, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, this is all the top guys at DC. And then you probably know that there's been this change of direction at DC, and I think...
It's a change from the new 52 back to the old continuity.
Something like that. Yeah. And that's affected their thinking on everything. So apparently that's the reason. They pulled the plug on it. So now I'll tell you what it was. It was martial law meets Batman. Oh. And, you know, Kevin and I spent a wonderful weekend working that story out, and they pulled the plug on it. But you can imagine what Kevin had in mind. I'll tell you just what, I mean, he came up with some of my favorite images on it. And because it's an alternative Earth, so we thought, is that okay? Yeah, you can do what you like. That's what they said. So we had all these Batman from various parallel Earths all dead and being piled up with martial law on top of them, etc., etc. You could probably imagine the rest. It was really cathartic.
I'd read it, I've got to tell you.
Yeah. Do you think over the period, I mean, you've been involved with, you know, the whole length of 2018, are there any missed opportunities, something you would have liked to have done or you tried to do, or did something that didn't quite come off that you think now, I think that would have worked well?
Not in a specific way. I think, I suppose I've always, with all of us on 2000 AD in the early stages and doubtless later as well, I think we all felt it should have been so much bigger. So that, if you like, that's, I know that's a bit generalized, but we all felt it should have been so much bigger than it actually was. I'm quite passionate about this, that, for example, if you consider that Games Workshop started at the same time as us, and role-playing is hardly, at the time at least, was not ahead of comics. Comics were a much more natural thing to spend your money on rather than figurines. And look how big Games Workshop are. We should have been Comics Workshop, if you like. And the fact that we weren't comes down to a big subject, which I'd only just just mention in passing, because otherwise we could get bogged down on it, which is, if we'd followed the French model, which is where they have a proper rights deal, the reason that French artists spend forever on their work, and you know, you look at Drouillet and Mobius and so on, is because basically it's 50% to publisher and 50% to the creators, and that roughly follows on everything. So you actually get a better return. And unfortunately, that doesn't apply in the UK. There's a legacy of selling all rights. And so that does result in this speed thinking, which in its heyday, you have guys saying, hey, I make more money than the British Prime Minister. He was probably right at that time. And in recent years, what happens is, you probably know about this, that there are various very talented artists who, it's not their fault, they have a day job as well. In other words, they have to do this in their spare time.
Yeah.
And so that's a shame, but it's a big subject, so I'll stop there on that one.
So are there any characters that you would have liked to have maybe seen go off? I mean, ABC Warriors, Robusters, anyone you would have liked to seen go off in a slightly different direction? Maybe once from the early days even, you know?
I think one of the things that was fun in the early days was the fact that characters built up momentum. They're a bit like Coronation Street. They're in the comic all the time.
Yeah.
And I think that absence of that is something that there's no way around it, because you can't have it both ways. If you have more than one artist drawing a story, that's not really the way things are done anymore. But you know, if a story only appears every 3 years, like, for example, Greysuit, you think, what the hell is that all about? You've got to, it loses traction.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think that's a kind of regret, if you like. Mm.
Going forward then, let's say going forward, what would you like to see? What do you think will work in the future? If you had to say, right, we should go this way, we should do these sort of stories, what sort of thing?
Well, I suppose the stories I'm currently writing, I'm pretty happy with. Otherwise, I wouldn't be doing them. Because, as I say, all those years ago in the garden shed, it just made me miserable as hell. I don't want to go back to that. So I'm very happy with the stories I am writing. I think one of the things that interests me, and I don't know if it's possible within in the context of 2000 AD, is is to try and reach those younger readers. I don't think it has to be one or the other. Again, I think a Games Workshop. You see kids of, I don't know, 7, 8, 9, 10, and, you know, game players of, you know, up to 60 or beyond.
Yeah.
So I miss those younger readers. And very occasionally, I've done straw polls with, you know, testing out stories on kids. Actually, in
we
the
talked about it with Misty, didn't you?
Yeah. And it's really fascinating because they don't know who the hell I am and they don't care. They're just looking at it as a story. And so you haven't got that momentum of, you know, if you've got a, you know, a heritage of lots of great stories behind you, people will be a bit more tolerant with you, if you like. So they're just looking at you. They don't care.
Yeah
this was good. And I actually like that experience of working for... So I miss that. And if I could engineer that in any way, I would.
In the way that sort of characters now driven, comics are driven by the characters that create them sometimes now. You know, we've gone over that tipping point where you introduced, for many people, credits on comics, didn't you, back in the day?
Yep.
We've now gone quite past that where personality is almost a driving factor in purchase. Does that think make sense?
You mean the authors?
Or the authors, especially the writers. You know who the writers are, you know.
Yeah, I mean, I for the most part, I think 90% that's a good thing. Because I mean, it was Kevin who sneaked the bylines in and it changed everything overnight. Because suddenly, for the first time, you realize, that's why this one is crap, because it's written by writer X and I like this one and so on. And that was so revolutionary what he did and so subversive the way he did it. But I think, I think the downside is perhaps that you get... I don't know, perhaps it's more about the author rather than his character sometimes. I don't know. I think there is a downside. Yeah.
Okay. Right. We're going to move on now to Read 'Em and Weep. Just a quick chat about that, and then we're going to open up to some questions from the audience. Just a little straw poll. Who's bought Read 'Em and Weep or read it so far? Quite a few of you. Okay. Well, here's a little summary that I wrote about a minute ago. It's the first book in a proposed series of darkly comic thrillers set in swinging London in the comic-making industry. Murder, drugs, experimental sex, and violent newsagents. So how did it come about, Pat? How did the book sort of come about?
Well, Kevin and I were, I think probably like a lot of us here, maybe are fascinated by that whole 70s era and the kind of characters and the politically incorrect behavior.
Marvelous, isn't it?
Yeah. things that couldn't happen today. And we thought it would be a good basis for a sitcom. So we put it together as a sitcom with a kind of W.C. Fields kind of character who's an editor, but who hates kids. You know, so we thought that was, you know, a good...
Yeah. We'll get on to whether that's based on anyone, really.
You'll never get me to admit that. We submitted it to the BBC, and there was a producer there, Gareth, producer of Spaced, who liked it, had a kind of comic background from his point of view, too.
Yeah.
And so asked us to make some changes, and then we signed off on it. And then he took it to his boss, and his boss also liked it, thought it was funny, but he said those words that... we're probably all a little familiar with, it's too niche, you know.
Okay.
And you just can't get past that, you know. So we tried it in various forms. Radio 4 were interested for a while, but they said it was, which I think this one I would challenge them on, they said it was too visual for radio. So you can't win on that one. I mean, I know there's lots of radio producers who would disagree with that. But anyway... So we had these characters, and we just had so much affection for them that in the end, I thought, well, there's only one way to do this, really, which is to explore it as a novel. In other words, to open these characters up. Why is this guy, he has a weird obsession with fur. Where does that come from? Why does he hate kids? And there are strong clues, because he goes to the newsagents every Saturday for his comic, which is called The Fortney One. And so he says to the newsagent, please, sir, and the newsagent says, come on, you know what you want. Are you waiting for this? Please, sir, can I have a Fortney one? And the newsagent punches him in the face because that's the... So, you know, that, if you like, was the motivation. So it just kind of spiraled from there. And I thought, well, if we're starting with, if you like, a kind of fictional history of battle in volume one, then we have to move on to action in volume two, 2000 AD, and volume three, and Misty in volume four.
Oh, brilliant. Okay, cool. So I know there's some great one-liners in it. There's Girls Like Wolves. One of my favourites. What was the other one? You can't write a story about a black footballer, son. Anyway.
Yeah. And that was all taken from real life, because when I started Action, I had a black boxer. I mean, what else would you have? You know. And the managing editor said, you can't have a black boxer as a hero. I'm looking at him like,
okay.
You know, and he said no, and he actually brought out some artwork of an old story, which he said I was welcome to. It's like, yeah, right, with a white boxer with a black sidekick. Now, attitudes in 1975 are no different today. Yeah, I mean, you know, the world had changed by 1975, but not in comics. They were still stuck in some Edwardian world. So I had the equivalent of that with a black footballer, which in some ways is probably more controversial, because it would have incited, and I'll cover it in volume two, it would have incited violence on the terraces, and there was violence,
really?
Racist.
Wow. Okay.
I mean, in West Ham, there was a West Ham striker. Yeah.
Yeah. So did you get any phone calls from anyone saying, is this me, Pat? Is this meant to be me?
Not thus far. And I should say, in my defense, that they are characters. So what I mean by that is, we started with saying, okay, we have one who's like W.C. Fields, who hates kids. So there's got to be someone at the other end who's the very opposite of it. And if we had based people too closely on real life, we would have limited them. There are about three or four clearly identifiable, very recognizable characters, but generally, from a homage point of view, so I think Kevin and I go quite over the top over the late, great Ken Reed.
Okay.
He's just absolutely brilliant cartoonist, and who was doing Monty Python-type black comedy years before the Cambridge Footlights.
Okay, yeah. So I know that a lot of people haven't read it yet, so where are we going next with it? What's the sort of feeling? So it's a murder mystery, don't forget that, as well as being a homage or on the comic industry, but which isn't quite... We haven't got there yet, have we?
Yeah, volume one is laying the foundations. So volume two, things get worse, and volume three, they get worse. So it's that classic three-act movie thing where things just... You just have to keep making things worse and worse for the protagonist. I mean, otherwise you get bored. You can plateau in a comic, I think, in some ways that you certainly can't in a novel, and you can't, in my opinion, in a movie. In a comic, you can. You can jog along. Perhaps in a TV series, the same thing. You know, you can move. But really, you just got to keep ramping it up.
Yeah.
In other words, you make life hell for your central characters.
It's not great for them at the moment, to be fair. You know, so
He's pursued by all kinds of demons and problems. I mean, personal problems and so on. And you just keep ramping up the conflict, and the murders will increase. The killings increase, and so on.
Mm. What about who's the fur fetish? Just before we move on, anyone? Who's the fur? Who in the industry has a fur fetish? Anyone you want to disclose?
Well, you see, that really proves my point that these really are fictional characters, because Kevin had this. Kevin told me he collects these wonderful, strange pieces of information, and he was telling me that there's apparently people have this real weird obsession with fur. And this is before...
Just a coincidence that you knew that then, I take it, yeah.
And this is before the furry thing, which came in the 80s with kind of furry fantasy, all that kind of stuff. This dates back to his mother and her fur coat and God knows what else.
Yeah.
So you, in a novel, you can delve into that background. It's like Alan Partridge. You think of Alan Partridge, there's all kinds of weird stuff, but you'd have to read one of the books to to actually know why all this weird stuff's going on.
Yeah, it goes there, definitely. Yeah, very good. If you haven't read it, I highly recommend it. It had me chuckling, I've got to tell you. So just before we open up, we're running a little bit late. What have you got coming out? What's the next few things you've got coming out, Pat?
Well, in 2000 AD terms, let's see. I'm writing a next series of ABC Warriors, drawn by Clint Langley. Simon Davis is working on the fourth and final volume of Britannia Chronicles.
Outstanding.
And of course, you've got the 40th birthday issue. Is it next week or something? It's out because it obviously isn't out because no one's brought a copy along.
Okay. Yeah.
And so there are two stories of mine in there. One is by Simon Davis, and I think I'm quite pleased with the sort of black comedy of that. And the other is by Clint, and it's a Robusters story.
Brilliant. Excellent. Yeah. Can't wait. So, right. So, any questions from the audience? One at the back there. Do we have a microphone at all? There you go. It's coming. 2 seconds. Put your hand up again if you don't mind. There you go. Over there, dude.
Can I ask you what your best and worst memories of Dundee are?
Oh, wow. Well, the best is probably relatively easy, which is an affection for popular culture. And that is a Scottish thing, and I banged on about this before. Maybe it's because I'm Anglo-Irish. I'm looking at it from the outside, because I think Scottish people take it for granted. But it's such a different culture that the attitude to comics is so different there to the English attitude. I know it's a generalization, but in broad terms. So I don't know, I come from a sort of half working class, half middle class background. And I was really surprised by the affection for really down market magazines. And so that was something I kind of picked up on. And that's a very strong memory, a very fond memory. A more negative memory, and this is a relatively safe one, as I'm like 20 years old when I'm a trainee journalist there, and I'm reading manuscripts for People's Friend, you know, which is designed for very senior citizens and very, very dour Scottish seniors. Well, that's the impression for me, at least. It's like I'm bored out of my brains, you know, reading these kind of stories. But overall, great affection for that popular culture that DC Thompsons were responsible for.
Did we get the worst memory there? Was it
Working on People's Friend? Reading manuscripts of People's Friend?
No, actual fighting in sheds, but yeah. Next, anyone else? Stand up, dude. There you go.
Thank you. So I think you touched on this earlier, Pat. I mean, you're talking about how we engage the next generation of followers of 2000 AD, and I think the problem is with the compressed format, it's very hard for them to get engaged very quickly. And so what do you think is the future for getting the next generation of fans involved? And second question, in your role as being one of the leaders of the movement, what was the strangest situation when you came across somebody you never would have guessed was actually a 2000 AD fan?
Well, to start with the first one, yeah, it is a problem that everything is compressed. And so how would new, younger readers get into it? And
yeah.
I suppose the answer, it sounds like it would be rather difficult. But I actually think it wouldn't be. What I would do if were I in the driving seat, God help me. I would go along to one of these computer game shops and look at, you know, whether it's Assassin's Creed or you know, one of those car thieves stories or whatever, and see what was really gripping, what should we say, the 11-year-olds, the 12-year-olds.
Okay.
And I would devise a story, and I would find some way whereby it can appear in 2000 AD as new, but somehow reach, you know, through marketing techniques. I mean, you've got the whole internet thing where it could reach those 11-year-olds. It's a matter of willpower. And I'm not sure there is it needs a lot of willpower and a lot of motivation. And I suppose as things are moving along okay, there isn't that that ferocious desire to do it. I mean, one of the reasons 2008 is so strong when it kicked off was because there was so much negativity towards it from the people around me. It had to work. But you know, once it's working, you can kind of relax a bit.
The underdog mentality almost had to, you know.
It was very much the underdog. They really, it sounds bizarre, I've come across it in many occasions in British publishing. You would think people, for the most part, would want things to succeed. Not true. And that probably applies, especially with large corporations, because if an editor has got a salary and everything, why does he want the hassle of something new? And a lot of people just wanted their redundancy, and they just wanted to leave. So there was no affection. And I think that's the difference now over the last, since Rebellion took over, is that you've got people who actually like what they're doing. Back in the past, and not so distant past, a lot of people didn't actually like British comics. They, you know, whether it was they just wanted another job, or whether they wanted, to work on Vertigo or something. But I think you've really got to like British comics. I think that's, and if you do, then you can find a way. Not sure. Could you repeat your second question?
Who's the least likely 2000 AD fan you've ever met?
The least likely. I might come back to you on that. I shall think about that.
Anyone else?
Hi, Pat. Would we have ended up with 2000 AD had Action Comic not have folded? And if Action hadn't have folded, would we be sat here celebrating 40 years of that instead?
Good question, yeah.
In the novels, that's actually the sort of direction I want to go, is what could have been. Yeah, because Action was, in a way, was doomed, because it was so clearly doing that to the establishment. And I wasn't actually in charge at that point. You probably know the story that the poor guy who was ended up as editor of Action, his previous credential had been he was editor of Bobo Bunny.
Classic.
And so he didn't know where to draw the line. And I think a lot of you will be aware of how skillful a lot of us have been in 2000 AD at knowing just how far to slip under the radar, you know, and saying, well, it's not a human being, it's a robot. So I think Action would have been particularly tough. But the one that does spring to mind is Battle. Now, Battle should still be around today. And I don't know the full story, so someone may want to correct me on this, but my feeling is because they took on those awful Action Force toys, so that people who were enjoying Battle, like Commando readers, suddenly their comic is turned into this rather wretched, you know, let's have the money, you know, the licensing money. I think it's offensive to kids to do that, just as I think it's offensive the whole Hatch, Match, and Dispatch. You know, that was the Credo of comics, that they would bring one comic out and then merge another one into it with great news
bigger
inside.
Yeah.
I'm sure a lot of you must have been so pissed off. And I made my views known on the subject. Yeah.
Star-Lord, Tornado, it was all a moment, wasn't it?
Yeah. It's insulting to readers. It's like, what the hell is this other comic that I'm being swallowed
forced
up by?
Forced upon me, almost, wasn't it? Huh? Yeah, it was almost forced upon you, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was.
And you didn't
know
it was coming because there was no internet, and suddenly it was there.
But Battle should still be around. And Misty, if I'd stayed on Misty, I think not only would Misty be around today, because it's actually an easier gig than 2000 AD, and female readership is potentially much larger. There is a great regret for me. If I'd stayed with it, I think it'd be around today. I think it'd be bigger than 2000 AD because of the demographics, the fact that women read more than guys.
Anyone else? Over there.
Hello. Thanks to 2000 AD and the Beano, I actually learned to read because I struggled with dyslexia without being noticed when I was quite young. Stories including ones of your own. I now do a lot of teaching with children that struggle with a similar thing using comic books. They're a great way of getting them to just try and read. Although 2000 AD is not aimed at kids, have you ever thought about stories that could, kind of like the company that's kind of come out of things recently doing other stuff linked to Beano and that. Do you think there's anything 2000 AD could possibly do in the future that could be aimed more at the younger kids that are struggling? Do you think that's a possibility?
So like a junior cop?
Yeah.
It's a tricky one because I no one ever mentions it anymore, but I think there was a period of time where was it a junior Judge Dredd or something?
It was attempted.
I quite like to see that. I don't know exactly what he did, but I think one of the things to everyone's credit is the various embarrassing mistakes we all make, you never mention them. So, but I think, again, rather like if you wanted to pull in younger readers, as an example I was giving, I think in a similar way, you could perhaps bring in some stories which, without patronizing the readers, because, God, I mean, we'd be shot at dawn if we ever did that. I mean, you think of, you know, Space Girls and things like that. I mean, so, but I think if, without being too worthy about it, I think if there was a story which didn't require a massive amount of reading and so on, I think there's always a way if you want to find a way. Yeah.
Thanks. One more, I think. I think we've got time for one more at least.
It was just a simple question. What historical source did you use for Charlie's War for the intervention in Russia in 1918-1919? Was it Pearl's History of the First World War? Because there's really very, very little actual on that disastrous campaign in North Russia.
Yeah, the book, I only discovered the best book on the subject in recent years, and this is the one anyone who's interested in that area, is a book by John S. Clarke. His name's on Wikipedia and so on. And he portrays Britain's role as much more damning than the role that I had playing. The British officer class behaved like complete animals. It was Britain's Vietnam, and it's been hushed up. Now, I only had, I think, maybe two sources. One was the whole train wars that were going on, which is actually very great comic book material, where you had these giant trains with huge guns on them firing at each other. But the gritty down-to-earth details that I was looking for, I can't remember what I got, but it was very limited, the material. But John S. Clarke, he really portrays the shameful history of the British Empire. And he's one of my personal heroes who I, in these centenary years, I've tried to do a story about, and I think the chances of getting it off the ground are very, very slim. There is a media blackout, a very deliberate one by the establishment, to block out anything that's anti-war, and you become very aware of it if you go to France, where Charlie's War actually sells probably better than in Britain, because they don't have this clampdown. There's endless stories glorifying our truly evil generals, like General Haig. So things like Blackadder goes forth, you won't see that on terrestrial television in the centenary years. It's really shameful. Yeah, you can see I get quite passionate on the whole thing, yeah.
I think we will have one more. Let's have one more question at the back there.
Pat, what are you reading at the moment?
Question?
God, yeah. I'm reading I, Alan Partridge. And it's great fun because there are so few black comedy. I want to make sure that the novel we're doing stays on the right tram lines. And surprisingly, You would imagine there'd be quite a few novels, like, say, Father Ted and things like that. But to my knowledge, there's only Alan Partridge. That's the only black comedy novel that's actually out there.
Okay, interesting. Mm. Okay, well, one last question from me before we round up. You get to choose one of your stories from 2000 AD. Yeah. Which one is you think sums up the best way you approach 2000 AD and your favourite, the one you had the most fun writing, which would it be?
I think it has to be Nemesis.
Brilliant.
Yeah. I think so. Thank you.
On that, I think we'll end it. Everyone, round of applause. Pat Mills.
Thanks very much.
Appreciate it.